Good morning. You're watching the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Ashwarya Kapoor with you. All the big stories from India and across the world coming up ahead. First up, the headlines. Rajya Sabha slated to take up Special Economic Zones Amendment Bill 2019 today. Bill passed by Lok Sabha yesterday allows trusts to set up units in SEZs. Calling attention motion on climate change also listed in the upper house. Lok Sabha scheduled to discuss Homeopathy Central Council Amendment Bill 2019, Aadhaar and Other Laws Amendment Bill, three key bills including Central Educational Institutions, Reservation in Teachers Cadre Bill listed for introduction. Prime Minister Narendra Modi gets a warm welcome in Osaka ahead of the G20 summit. Prime Minister to meet Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe today. Home Minister Amit Shah takes a stock of development projects in Jammu and Kashmir, directs adequate security measures for Amarnath Yatra. And unbeaten India look to seal semi-final berth in a World Cup to take on West Indies in Manchester today. Pakistan keep themselves in the race with a 6-wicket win against New Zealand in Birmingham. First up, news on the budget session of Parliament, and first a look at the legislative business that is listed in today's agenda in the Lok Sabha. The Central Educational Institutions Reservation in Teachers Cadre Bill 2019 will be moved and introduced by Union Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank. The bill aims to fill up more than 7,000 existing vacancies by direct recruitment in accordance with the new quota system. It will replace the Central Educational Institutions Reservation in Teachers Cadre Ordinance 2019. And Union Minister Dr. Harshvardhan will move and introduce the Indian Medical Council Amendment Bill 2019 to amend the Indian Medical Council Act 1956. The bill is aimed at bringing in transparency, accountability and quality in the governance of medical education in the country. It also aims to provide for the supersession of the Medical Council of India for a period of 2 years from August 2018. And Dr. Harshvardhan will also move and introduce the Dentist Amendment Bill 2019 to amend the Dentists Act 1948. The amendment will help restructure the dental councils, and the representation of the central government members and elected members would no longer be made mandatory in the dental councils. And Ayush Minister Shripad Yesso Naik will move the Homeopathy Central Council Amendment Bill 2019 for consideration and passing. The bill amends the Homeopathy Central Council Act 1973, and it seeks to extend the period of reconstitution of the Central Council from an existing period of 1 year to 2 years. And Union Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad will move for consideration in passing the Aadhaar and Other Laws Amendment Bill 2019. The bill proposes the voluntary use of Aadhaar as an identity proof for opening bank accounts and procuring mobile connections. And the Special Economic Zones Amendment Bill 2019 was passed by the lower house yesterday. The bill seeks to allow trusts to set up units in Special Economic Zones or the SEZs. Introducing the bill, Commerce and Industry Minister Piyush Goyal said that Special Economic Zones play an important role in promoting exports and economic growth of the country. Goyal said that in 2014, SEZs created 12 lakh jobs, and in 2019, it rose to 20 lakh. The minister also rejected suggestions by Congress leader in Lok Sabha, Adhir Ranjan Chaudhary, that the concept of SEZ has failed in India.
देश में investment निवेश आए, देश की आर्थिक प्रगति डीले ना हो, और इसलिए statement में भी लिखा गया है कि चूंकि हम international financial services centers वगैरह इस देश में आए, निवेश आए, अलग-अलग प्रकार के जो modern investment के vehicles हैं. वो भी इस देश में आ सके उसमें इस देश में कोई विलंब होने से किसी को लाभ नुकसान नहीं था जैसे ही ध्यान में आया और सेबी ने एक नोटिफिकेशन निकाला जिसके तहत ऑल्टरनेट इन्वेस्टमेंट फंड्स को अलाउ किया कि वो भी इन्वेस्ट कर सके, तो सरकार को लगा कि ये अच्छा रहेगा कि देश में ऑल्टरनेट इन्वेस्टमेंट फंड्स के माध्यम से स्पेशल इकोनॉमिक जोन यानी जो फाइनेंस के क्षेत्र में इंटरनेशनल फाइनेंशियल सर्विसेज सेंटर के रूप में काम करती हैं उसमें भी ये अलाउ किया जाए।
एसीजेड वॉज फास्ट इंस्टॉल्ड मोर देन सिक्स डिकेड्स अगो, दैट इज नो 2005 इट हैज बीन कम इनटू एग्जिस्टेंस बाय द एक्ट। Don't try to belittle the concept of SEZ. Our question is, Mr. Piyush Goyalji, why the SEZ has been a success story in China, whereby we have been failed to achieve the desired result?
Mani Sadashya,
SEZ has become an engine of manufacturing in China.
Kriti Mishra, our colleague, is now joining us live from Vijay Chowk. A very good morning, Kriti. So, discussion on two key bills slated in the lower house today. Discussion on the bill that will help the Central Council of Homeopathy in exercising its powers and performing the functions of the council, and also discussion on the bill related to Aadhaar. And three key bills also to be introduced in the lower house. So a lot of legislative agenda slated for the day today.
Absolutely, Ashwara. So it's a heavy legislative agenda as far as the lower house is concerned. So the important Aadhaar and other laws amendment bill would be taken up. Remember, this bill imposes strict penalties in case of violations and also makes Aadhaar optional for opening bank accounts for KYC. There's another important bill, which is the Homeopathy Central Council Amendment Bill, that seeks to extend the reconstitution term of the Central Council and extend the term of Board of Governors to further strengthen the council for amendments. So these are the important bills, and several other important bills are slated for introduction in the lower house. For instance, the Dental Amendment Bill, the Dentist Amendment Bill, and also the Indian Medical Council Amendment Bill. So important bills are lined up to be taken up in the lower house today. Ashwarya?
Absolutely. So heavy legislative agenda in the lower house. And now a look at today's agenda in the Rajya Sabha. The Special Economic Zones Amendment Bill 2019 will come up in the upper house today for consideration and passing. The bill became the first legislation to be passed by the newly constituted 17th Lok Sabha yesterday. And in the post-lunch session, a calling attention motion by SP MP Revati Raman Singh is also listed in today's business to discuss the situation arising out of climate change in the country and the steps taken by the government on the issue. And the issue of climate change and water crisis is resonating in Parliament with this session, with the MPs cutting across party lines, raising this issue and calling for immediate steps to be taken. Prime Minister Modi yesterday said that there are 226 districts in the country hit by water crisis. He asserted that the government was making efforts to mobilize everyone to tackle the crisis and give a priority to water in the MPLAD funds.
सर्वे किया पानी का, करीब 226 डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऐसे ध्यान में आए हैं जहां पानी के लिए काफी जद्दोजहद करनी पड़ती है। किस राज्य में है मेरा मुझसे नहीं है, पैरामीटर के आधार पर अब मैं सबको मोबिलाइज कर रहा हूं। आप सभी, आपकी भी मदद चाहूंगा कि हम पानी के काम को कैसे बल दें, MPLAD फंड में भी प्रायोरिटी पानी को कैसे दें, उन कामों को कैसे दें। एक बार हम इस समस्या से देश को बाहर लाए, क्योंकि पानी की समस्या से देश को बाहर लाना चाहिए और पानी के संबंध में समाज को जागरूक करना भी उतना ही जरूरी है ताकि भविष्य में नवी आने वाली पीढ़ियों को पानी के संकट से बचाया जाए।
Let's go back to Kriti Mishra, who's joining us live from Vijay Chowk. Kriti, so talking about Rajya Sabha, the Special Economic Zones Amendment Bill 2019 became the first legislation to be passed by the newly constituted 17th Lok Sabha, and it will now be moved for passage in the Rajya Sabha. Important bill that seeks to allow trust to set up units in SEZs. And apart from that, of course, the calling attention motion on climate change. You know, we have seen how water crisis issue has resonated in both houses. So important legislative business in upper house as well.
Well, Aishwarya, the government has underscored the need and also unleashed several measures to promote economic activity, industrial development as well as exports. Now, this particular bill seeks to further propel exports and allow any entity or trust notified by the central government to set up units in the SEZs. The government also apprised the members of the Lok Sabha yesterday that SEZs created more than 12 lakh jobs in 2014 and more than 20 lakh jobs in 2019. In fact, after the ordinance was promulgated, more than 6 applications have been received by the government to set up SEZs. So another important bill by the government in the Lok Sabha, in the Rajya Sabha today. And as far as the other business is concerned, another very imperative business in today's agenda is of calling attention motion. Remember, climate change is one of the reasons for global concerns, and the UN body Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has pointed out that climate change will result in erratic rainfall, severe droughts and flood and temperature differences. India, in fact, is committed to aligning to its policies to Paris Accord of Climate Change of 2016, limiting the temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius at the pre-industrial levels. The government, in fact, is also promoting electronic vehicles to combat climate change and also has tasked scientist N.H. Ravindranath to conduct a local study on the impact of climate change. So the members will seek the answers from the government on the solution to combat climate change. So important day in the Rajya Sabha as well. Over to you, Aishwarya.
All right, Kriti. Thank you so much for all those updates there on Parliament. Thank you so much. And Prime Minister Modi made a strong case for simultaneous elections in the country on Wednesday in the Rajya Sabha. Pitching for a constructive debate on one nation, one election, Prime Minister Modi said that simultaneous polls will not, harm the political interests of the regional parties. Here's a report.
Mooting the idea of simultaneous elections for the Lok Sabha and the state assemblies, Prime Minister Narendra Modi underscored the need for a spirited debate on the issue. He drew the attention of the House to the recently concluded simultaneous elections in Odisha while praising the political maturity and understanding of the voters.
Odisha mein gramin ilaka jyada hai. Odisha ekdam bahut hi viksit aur aisa to rajya nahi hai. भारत के जो जिन राज्यों को अभी भी विकास के राह में लाने के लिए मेहनत करनी पड़े ऐसे राज्यों में से वहां के मतदाताओं ने लोकसभा के लिए एक मतदान किया, विधानसभा के लिए दूसरा मतदान किया. इसका मतलब हमारे मतदाताओं को एक ही समय विवेक बुद्धि का पूरा है. मैं तो कुछ तो सीटें ऐसी है कि जहां नीचे की सारे असेंबली सीटें विधानसभा में गई बीजेडी को और लोकसभा उन्होंने बीजेपी को.
The Prime Minister also noted that holding separate elections was an expensive exercise.
चुनाव के reforms की भी काफी बातें हुई हैं. हम 52 से लेकर के आज तक लगातार चुनाव में reform होते ही रहे और होते रहने चाहिए. और मैं मानता हूँ इसकी चर्चा भी लगातार होती रहनी चाहिए, उसके अंदर खुले मन से चर्चा होनी चाहिए, बंधे मन से होने की कोई जरूरत नहीं है. लेकिन आउटराइट ये कह देना कि एक देश एक चुनाव के हम पक्ष में नहीं है, अरे चर्चा तो करो भाई. इलेक्शन के रिफॉर्म्स अनिवार्य है, कर होने रहने चाहिए.
The Election Commission has maintained that it is equipped to hold simultaneous elections, but the decision has to be taken at the political level. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
On to the other big story this morning, Prime Minister Narendra Modi arrived in Osaka in Japan for the G20 summit, and he was accorded a warm welcome at the Osaka airport. He was also welcomed by the people of the Indian community at the hotel. This will be Prime Minister Modi's 6th G20 summit. Over the next 3 days, Prime Minister Modi will hold a range of bilateral and multiple engagements to articulate India's views on the global platform. And ahead of leaving for the summit, Prime Minister Modi tweeted saying that issues such as women empowerment, artificial intelligence and common efforts to address challenges like terrorism will be high on India's agenda. In his departure statement, PM Modi said that the G20 summit will also be a platform for sharing India's strong developmental experience of the last 5 years, which provided the basis for a resounding mandate by the people of India. Prime Minister Modi said that he was looking forward to engaging with the leaders of our major partner countries on important issues of bilateral and global importance. And Indians gathered to welcome Prime Minister Narendra Modi in Osaka. They are quite excited and have high expectations from him in his second term. Rajya Sabha TV correspondent talked to the people of the Indian community who gathered in Osaka from different parts of Japan to welcome Prime Minister Modi.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi has arrived in Osaka, and you can see these are the people. Some of them were there, and some of them are still waiting there to meet Prime Minister. And you know, they are having flags in their hand. Are you waiting for Prime Minister to meet?
Yes, I'm eagerly waiting to meet Prime Minister in the evening. There is a community event planned to have interaction with the Indian community in Japan, where Prime Minister will deliver a speech about India and Japan relations.
Okay, what are you waiting for?
I am also waiting for the speeches from Pradhan Mantri Narendra Modi. I want to see how it goes when now India is at the sixth position in the world economy.
This morning we came from Tokyo actually to meet Prime Minister, and it was a good opportunity. So we really wanted to see how this G20 summit goes. It is basically a big summit where the policies will be made, and I participated in workshops, so I really want to see what kind of policies.
You came from Tokyo, I think a 2 hours journey at least.
By Shinkansen, but but still very far from.
And you?
I met Prime Minister very first time, and I was very excited to meet him, and I'm happy right now.
Why are you waiting for Prime Minister so eagerly?
So actually, last year I met him at Kobe last year also, and I really appreciate. I really love him, and I respect him. So yeah, I really like him, so I want to meet him.
Okay, so you can see that people from different parts of India who are living in Japan, they have traveled hours together to meet Prime Minister and see him. I think it is very interesting time for them. And they also get encouraged when their Prime Minister come here and when the Prime Minister interacts here. And they will love to see that how Prime Minister talks to G20 leaders, so that interest of the country is over everything all over the world. Akhilesh Soman for Rajya Sabha Television with cameraperson Prasanta Karmakar in Osaka of Japan.
And in fact, Akhilesh Soman is now joining us live from Osaka in Japan. Akhilesh, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi landed in Japan this morning for the G20 summit. And on the sidelines of the summit, he will attend several key meetings with the world leaders, including the much anticipated talks with US President Donald Trump tomorrow. What is the Prime Minister's itinerary for today?
You know, Prime Minister's most important meeting today is a meeting with Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe. You know, it will be around 1:50 Japan time. So you can see that Japan is a host country, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe has very good chemistry for a long time. I can say that for last 5 years or so, they had been functioning like friends rather than two colleagues in international affairs. So I think that Shinzo Abe also wants to talk to Prime Minister Narendra Modi that how he wants to see and how he thinks that how G20 should be discussed, and what are the agenda that Prime Minister Narendra Modi will like to put forward for the consideration of G20 leaders. So I think this is going to be a very important meeting, not only in G20 terms, but also in bilateral terms, because bilaterally also Prime Minister and Japan's Prime Minister have high hopes with each other. And now at the time when, you know, US-China trade war is threatening every country in the world, I think India is becoming the biggest hope for everyone, and in same way Japan's. And I think that Prime Minister Narendra Modi will talk to him both bilaterally and also G20 issues. And as far as G20 issues are concerned, you can understand that Japan is also trying to mediate in between US and Iran also, because US-Iran issues are also hampering the growth and development of countries like India.
Yes.
That is, you know, needs a oil supply consistently, and because of US-Iran, you know, confrontation, this supply of oil is getting impeded, not
yes.
only for India, but many other countries who are developing and who had, you know, supply from Iranian oil. So Japan is one of the key countries which is trying to mediate between US and Iran. So I think this is also going to figure between the talks with both the prime ministers. And other than these two important things, Prime Minister is also going to address, you know, Indian community in Japan. And
yes.
it is the old practice of Prime Minister that whenever he goes goes to any country, he likes to interact with the Indian community there, and it works two ways. One way it works that, you know, that Indian community also get confidence that yes, there is a prime minister who comes to talk to us and who communicates with us. And earlier, as you have seen, that I was talking to Indian some Indian young people, actually they are very young people who are working here, and they have very high hopes from prime minister, and they also want to see that India should develop the way technologically advanced Japan has developed. So I think they also interact, they also give message, and prime minister also gets encouragement from those interactions. So yes, I think this gives also message to the local government of Japan that yes, you know, Indian community gets respect that prime minister is meeting. So I think it works very well as far as diplomacy is concerned, and also it works very well beyond diplomacy. People of India who are at work in their offices in Japan, they also get respect from fellow Japanese other countries. So it's like a boosting of Indians who are living abroad. And the host country who also gets confidence that yes, Indians are taken care of well. So I think the first day of Prime Minister, the most important thing is this. And tomorrow there will be formal summit issues. And you know that one of the major issues is Donald Trump meeting.
Yes,
you know,
indeed. So over the next 3 days, PM Modi to hold almost 10 bilateral meetings, including with Chinese President Xi Jinping. Of course, key is the meeting between PM Modi and Donald Trump tomorrow, this being the first meeting after PM Modi's re-election for the second term. Thank you so much, Akhilesh, for all those updates from Osaka in Japan. And back home, Union Home Minister Amit Shah visited Jammu and Kashmir on Wednesday and reviewed the security situation in the state. Home Minister, who is on a two-day visit, was received by Governor Satyapal Malik and also some top officials of the state administration. Amit Shah also chaired a high-level meeting of civil administration officials and top bosses of various security agencies in the state. He was briefed about the overall security situation in the state, especially in the aftermath of the Pulwama terror attack. Amit Shah was informed about the steps being taken to eliminate top militant leadership while ensuring that no more Pulwama-like attacks were carried out. Shah was also briefed about the steps taken for ensuring smooth and safe conduct of the annual Amarnath Yatra, which is due to commence from 1st of July. Over 1 lakh people were excluded from the draft National Register of Citizens in Assam on Wednesday. This after they were found ineligible during the process of verification carried out by the local registrars of citizens registration. A statement by the state coordinator for the NPC. The additional exclusion list includes persons who were found ineligible on the presence on the grounds of being declared as foreigner, doubtful voters, or persons with the cases pending at foreigners' tribunals. The exclusion of more than 1 lakh people comes in addition to the 40 lakh names left out of the list that was published on 30th of July last year. Now, those excluded will be eligible to file claims, for which hearings will start from 5th of July. The NRC is being updated for the first time since 1951 under the monitoring of the Supreme Court, and the final list is scheduled to be released on 31st of July. And now our special segment on Budget 2019. Well, the fast-growing e-commerce market in the country is likely to touch $84 billion in 2021. And the growth in the e-commerce sector will also boost employment, exports, and provide better products and services to the customers. So let's take a look at the budget expectations of the e-commerce sector in India.
The e-commerce industry has been on an upward trajectory in India. It is expected to surpass the United States by the year 2034 and become the second largest e-commerce market in the world. Powered by growing internet and smartphone penetration, e-commerce saw 21 private equity and venture capital deals worth $2.1 billion in the year 2017. And 40 deals worth $1,129 million in the year 2018. In the upcoming budget, the industry expects to see efforts to put in place a robust and futuristic tax policy for the sector.
What is the biggest asset of an e-commerce company or e-commerce companies? It's the employees, people. Now, how do you get good talent, you know, and retain them? And for that, what we use is ESOPs. Now, ESOPs have a major flaw that they get taxed, employees get taxed when it's vested with them. But this should be taxed when they sell it, when they get the money, when the transaction takes place. So that is something that needs to be addressed.
Since 2014, the government has announced initiatives like Digital India, Make in India, Startup India, Skill India and Innovation Fund. Effective implementation of these programs have helped e-commerce growth with an emphasis on digitization and incentives for digital transactions.
E-commerce, any company that starts, we have losses initially a few years. You've got to carry forward them and take advantage. But, you know, so they need to look at it whether this carry forward losses are there and shareholding pattern has changed because of capital infusion or tax planning. So they need to look at this and try and fix that.
In February 2019, the government released the draft National E-Commerce Policy. The FDI policy for the e-commerce sector attempts to ensure a level playing field for all participants with a young demographic profile, rising internet penetration as the key drivers of the sector. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And our news from the ICC Cricket World Cup, an unbeaten Team India will face West Indies at Old Trafford in Manchester today. Now, India are on the verge of securing a World Cup semi-final berth. They need two more wins in four matches to seal the spot. The West Indies, on the other hand, are out of the top four race and will look to finish on a high. The match will begin at 3 p.m. India time. In yesterday's clash, Pakistan continued their revival in the World Cup by halting New Zealand's unbeaten run with a six-wicket victory. New Zealand has set a 238-run victory target for Pakistan in the league match, and Azam and Sohail showed intent, temperament and resolve while batting in Pakistan's must-win game. Now, Pakistan have now moved up to sixth spot in the table with 7 points. And with that, we wrap up this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching. Have a great day ahead.